Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Praise the Lord, everybody.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. The sun is shining and God has been good to us. Amen. We thank God for another opportunity to be in His presence. I want to welcome everybody to our friends and family day. As you all can see, I am dressed down as the flyer singer. I got on a t-shirt and shorts. I pray my strength in the Lord. This was not as easy as it looked. But we get ready to go ahead and get into our worship experience. Amen. We just ask that you would set your hearts and your minds on the things of God. Amen. Amen. So I would ask that everybody would join into our worship. Amen. Get what you need from God today. Today is the day, as David said, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Master, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. God, we thank you for all that you have done, all that you are doing, and all that you are about to do. Now, Master, in the name of Jesus, let your spirit have its way in this place. God, we thank you for your grace and mercy. We thank you for all that you have done, all that you are doing, and all that you are about to do. Now, Lord, we just ask that you would have your way in this place, God. Let your Holy Spirit reign supreme in here on today. God, give us a word that changes our life, that changes our minds, that changes our hearts. That changes the way we view ourselves, that changes the way we view your people, God. Give us peace in this time of storm. Lord, we thank you right now in the name of Jesus. God, we thank you that you didn't leave us. We thank you that you did not abandon us. We thank you that you did not let the enemy swallow us up in victory. God, we thank you all today because you've been good to us. We thank you that you've been kind. God, we thank you that you've been merciful. God, we thank you that while we were yet in sin, that you sent your son to die for us. And for that, God, we tell you thank you. God, we thank you for your grace. God, we thank you for your mercy. Master, we come today just to give you thanks. God, we come to give you thanks on today. We come to give you praise. God, we come to lift your name on high because you are worthy of all of the praise. Master, we ask that you have your way in this place, oh God. Lord, we thank you, oh God. God, we thank you on today. God, we thank you that last night our bed was not our cooling, Lord. God, we thank you that we woke up with the activity of our limbs. God, we thank you that while we may not have had everything we wanted, God, you did what you said you would do, and you supplied every one of our needs. God, we thank you that the enemy is not victorious over us. God, we thank you that we have a reasonable portion of our health and strength. God, we thank you that we are still in our right mind. God, we thank you that we're not in a mental. God, we're not smoking on drugs. God, we're not alcoholics. God, we say thank you because you've been good to us on today, God. God, we say thank you that you've been merciful to us on today. God, we thank you that on our way here, that we didn't get into a car accident, that our life was not in it. And for that, oh God, we give you praise in the mighty and precious name of Jesus, who is the Christ. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Sister Brittany Clark.
Amen.
That service will be at 1:30, where we get the opportunity to just really honor and thank her for being a part of our family. October 14th through the 16th, Bishop will be in Oklahoma. November 5th at 12 noon, Bishop's Elevation Service. That will be at Antioch Missionary Baptist Church, where the Dr. Reverend Posley is the shepherd. That is on 32nd and College, for those of us right here in town. And November 5th at 7 p.m., yours truly, Minister Clark will be ordained to the office of elder. December 2nd through the 4th, Bishop will be in Detroit, Michigan. We'd like to invite each and every one of you to partake in our celebrations as we move forward in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
The watches, it is your responsibility to get him here. Because you showed up, you all want God to be wherever you are. So as we get ready to go into this last song, I would just ask that you would just really be real with God on today. The Bible says that God is the Spirit, and they, that's us that worship, must worship in spirit and in truth. So I would definitely ask that you would tap into the Spirit of God on today.
Amen.
And allow him to speak to you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. probably already been to church, could have went home and got your fried chicken on, but you all decided to come out and worship with us. Amen. And I'm grateful that y'all did get y'all fried chicken on, because y'all didn't invite me to the chicken.
Amen.
That would be out of order.
Amen.
We do things decent and in order. Amen. So, y'all not allowed to eat chicken unless y'all invite me. Amen. Amen. So we do thank y'all, Father, for just thank y'all for, amen, the first lady of this house, amen, Sister Brittany.
Amen.
Amen. Friday, when I asked her if I could go and preach, she said, yeah, which was a little shocking, to be honest. I was a little bit surprised because it was the last minute and it was out of town. It wasn't like I was going right here in the city. I had to go to Monticello, Indiana, and I asked her, and she agreed. I thank the Lord for that.
Amen.
But I thank God for her because she was at work, and so I called a couple people to see if I could, you know, I didn't want to travel by myself. Excuse me. And after she agreed, she said, well, listen, if I could get off work, I'm going to go with you. And I just thank God for that, because there are so many times that pastors and leaders have to travel and they end up having to go solo.
Amen.
And while I found somebody to go with me, she understood the assignment and realized that I could not go by myself because nobody's going to cover me the way that she does.
Amen.
And they don't know exactly what to pray for. They may pray for me, but they don't know exactly what to pray. And so I just thank God that she went with us. When we'll be on Friday, amen. We had an awesome time. She enjoyed herself. And I will admit, this wasn't a black church. Wasn't no hugging and bugging. Wasn't no bumping and jumping. But listen, can I tell you something? These Caucasian folks, they went straight into worship, and they did not let up until we left. So much so that, as I said, it altered what I was preaching. And I told Brittany this morning, I said, listen, I would really appreciate if God would let me get through what he gave me today.
Amen.
So often, we as pastors, we prepare one thing to preach, and then we'll stand up and God will say something different. I don't know about other pastors, but I get frustrated, especially when he gives me something I did not study in a week.
Well,
and so I just be like, Lord, you can't just keep changing stuff on me. We thank God. We thank God for all that He is doing. Be by our hands for a quick word of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your grace. Lord, we ask that you would forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Master, created us a clean heart and renewed the right spirit within us. Now, God, I ask that you will cause me to decrease, and you and only you would increase. Master, allow these lips of clay to speak your words. Allow my tongue to be the pen of a ready writer.
Yes,
now, God, I just thank you for this opportunity to stand before this, your awaiting people. God, touch those that are watching via social media, and even those that are here in this room, God, that you would give them a word on today that changes their life for the better and changes them forever. In the mighty and precious name of Jesus, who is the Christ. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Would you just do me a favor and put your hands together real quick and give God some praise? Amen. This is our friend, our family and friends day. And I don't know what the Lord is doing, but I have I try not to be a themed preacher. Because I personally feel like that constrains me and it constrains the spirit in what God wants to say to us today. However, when I was designing the flyer, the worst thing they could have done was teach me how to make my own flyers. That is save money in my pocket because I don't have to pay for it now. I do my own. Thank you, Jesus.
Come on, somebody. Amen.
I make my own flyers. Hallelujah. Now I got to go get tons of more photos because I can't keep using the same pictures.
Same
pictures. I keep using the same photos, so now I got to go get. We got to go do a photo shoot, so we have some new pictures. was, amen. When I decided to name this Sunday, I was going to do our Summer Liturgy last this Sunday, but the Lord showed me something differently. And as I said last week, I was very unclear as to what I was preaching today after just coming out of our series, dealing with a familiar place. If you haven't had a chance to watch it, you can find it on the Swag Community Church page, or you can go to our YouTube page, and that entire series from start to finish is on the Swag Community Church YouTube page. And I said last week that I was sad that the series was ended because I had no clue what I was preaching today. And the Lord said, well, listen, if you don't have friends and family, then this is something that you need to talk about, is friends and family.
Amen.
I woke up Friday morning, got myself a cup of coffee, and I began to do my normal routine while my wife was at work. After I got the kids off of school, had my cup of coffee, and I got on social media to see what type of mischief had taken place while I was asleep. And at 9:00 in the morning, I discovered that a young lady was murdered in front of her children.
Yes.
A few hours later, the same young man that murdered this young woman gets into a shootout with the police, only to discover that it was not a coincidental shooting. But this young man was the father of her children. And he killed her. He killed his children's mother right in front of them. And then we discovered that the day before, she had just taken out a protective order against her. And the Lord said to me, listen, now you go ahead and you talk about friends and family. Because in the world that we are living in today, the Bible declares that in end times, that mothers will be turned against daughters and fathers against sons. That the life that we are living right now is playing out contrary to popular belief, just the way the Bible says. I've made a comment to several people in the last couple of weeks for watching what's going on in the world and in the church, that I'm sick of this church. This church got pity in it, there's something wrong with it. We have leaders that are jumping into position who are called on Sunday and they want to be elevated on Monday. Nobody really wants to dig into the Word of God. Nobody wants to wait their time. Nobody has a desire to hear from God and to learn the things of God before they try to lead God's people. Wow. And we wonder why the world is in the shape that it's in. And it's because, as the Bible says, I swear to y'all, I'm not preaching. This has nothing to do with my message, but this is what I feel. The reason the world is in the shape that it's in is because the church of today is missing the message. The church of today is missing the message. We would much rather make people feel good so that our churches grow than to hold folks accountable and tell them that, watch this, I don't care how much money you got in your bank account, what type of car you drive. If you ain't living right, you still going to hell. I don't care nothing about your tools. I don't care nothing about your parents. If you cannot love your neighbor as you love yourself, hell will steal your destination. Don't care nothing about your church hats or your wigs. If you are not doing what God has said, hell is still real. I don't know if this New Age church knows this, but hell is still real. Hell is still a place that, watch this, because of the penalty of sin. And what is amazing to me is that there are more people living a sinful lifestyle in the house of God than there is in the world. In the body of Christ, the Bible declares that, watch this, that there is a remnant, that's a small number of folks who come to church authentically, not because they want to hear the latest tea, but because they desire to get on their knees and get in God's face, to say, Lord, the old song says, Lord, don't move this mountain, just give me the strength to climb. There were some folks that still desire, and I feel like preaching this morning, for not being in order, but that was my tangent. I just had to get that out.
Amen.
I needed somebody. somebody else to hear my heart today. If you would you turn with me to the book of Luke, Luke chapter number 5. Luke chapter number 5. And I technically try not to have so many verses, but then I promise you, I'm going to make it all make sense. Luke chapter 5, starting at verse number 17, when you have a standing, say amen.
Amen.
Luke chapter 5, if you can hear say amen. Amen. Clearly my father wanted to stand as well. Escape entitled Friends. The song about them and catching and captivating, it also sets a standard for what true friendship should look like. The opening stanza of the first verse of this song, Houdini makes a profound and prophetic observation about the word friend. Houdini says, friend is a word we use every day, and most of the time we use it in the wrong way. You can look up the word time and time again, but the dictionary doesn't know the meaning of friend.
That's right.
Here Houdini is very clear that friends cannot be limited to Webster's definition of the word. We have all had people come and go in and out of our lives, and as suggested, we are all guilty of misclassification of people. We have all been guilty of making associates friends and making friends enemies. It is sometimes difficult to realize who is a friend and who isn't. With social media, such as Facebook, to be exact, some of us have an outrageous number of so-called friends, but the truth of the matter is that maybe less than half of the people on our page actually know us. Some of them are people, some of the people on our page, they know someone that we know and decided to send us a friend request. However, the Bible declares that a friend is someone that sticks closer than a brother. This helps us identify that our relationships with friends can more oftentimes be stronger than our bonds with family. The good book, First Lady, also tells us that there is an order to friendship. It declares that to be considered a friend, one must first show themselves friendly. I have to ask the question that how many of us have become friends with people that when we first encountered them were not very welcoming? We have called them our friends. Let me get back to my notes. This requires that the one wanting to be a friend to be honest and transparent up front. The statement scripture gives us a clear guidance on what godly friendship should look like. Yet because of our own superficial nature, we abandon what the Bible says to take a step, to take the stance that I hope this one works out. Friends share an intimate connection with one another. I don't mean sexual, but this type of intimacy allows friends to do and to say what others cannot at all. A real friend will tell you what you don't want to hear. Will challenge you to rise to the occasion. They call you on your mess, and they invest in your future. The Bible says in Samuel that David had a friend by the name of Jonathan, and the text opened up by saying, "And the soul of David was knit to the soul of Jonathan." When you have a real friend, and there is a bond that cannot be broken. I know that we only use this in reference to marriage, but the Bible also declares what God has joined together, let no man put asunder. That watch this, even in your mess, even in your dilemma, in your trials and your tribulations, if God has ordained this friendship, that it will stand the test of time.
Amen.
Here in Luke chapter 5, we find true friendship in action. The Bible says that that a man has a condition and he is aided by his friends to get better.
All right.
If you would allow me to use my sanctified imagination, these men could no longer let their friend stay where he was, but rather they decided to take him to Jesus. So if you would just give me a few minutes of your time, I'd like to preach from the subject, that's what friends are for. It is no coincidence. I'm done with my tablets, so I'm going to put this away. It is no coincidence that the last song before I preached was entitled, That's What Friends Are For. It is clear that in today's world, we really do need a friend. But let me help you out. Houdini said, your friendship cannot be defined by Webster's Dictionary. He says that no matter how many times you look up the word, no matter how many times you look up the meaning of the word, no matter how many times you find the Latin root word or the Greek word for the word friend, there is no real adequate definition for a friend, and Houdini, without speaking prophetically into our lives, letting us know that if we need to find real friendship and what friendship looks like, then we have to go to a source that really that has created and designed true friendship. He tells us that Webster can't do it, and so that leaves us one option, and that is to go to the sacred book and to look and to what the Bible says. The Bible declares that Abraham was God's friend. The songwriter said, "Who am I that thou art mindful of me, that you're thinking of me?" And the songwriter goes on to say, "I am a friend of God." But I would argue that the church of the 21st century cannot be a friend to God because we don't first know how to be friends to each other.
Come on.
Yeah, when somebody can pray for you and shout with you and then hear some tasty drama about you and spread it, that's not your friend. When folks in the church house can say to everybody that they don't like you, but then they want you to sit by them at a particular service, that's not your friend. We have confused some folks that are really just associates with being real friends.
Well,
friends require a certain level of intimacy that other people don't have access to.
Well,
yeah, there were certain things about your real friends that they know about you, that watch this. It's possible that your own family don't know.
Glory.
You pour your heart out to a real friend.
Right,
and some of us have made the mistake of allowing social media to become our sounding board for our personal problems, our relationship drama, and then we are confused at why everybody has our name in their mouth. Wow. And watch this, I want to help somebody out. But it's not that the devil don't like you, it's that you're too busy telling everybody what's wrong with you, and that's why folks want to talk about you. That's why people always have their name in your mouth. It's because you're giving them something to say.
Glory.
That's what friends are for. Hearing this text, Luke, Dr. Luke, who was not one of the original 12 disciples or apostles of Jesus Christ, but rather he was a disciple of the Apostle Peter. That's some educational for y'all real quick. Here in this text, Luke finds it appropriate to inform the body of Christ that there is a situation taking place. And watch this, he's very vague. This is unusual for Dr. Luke, because Luke, being a physician, is very detailed and orchestrated in his writing style. That is why some people argue that Luke may have possibly written the book of Hebrews with the help of the Apostle Paul, because of how articulate the text is. But here, in verse number 17, Luke opens up the text by saying, "And it came to pass on a certain day." Why is that important to us? Why does Luke say that it was a certain day? Because Luke wants you to understand that your relationship with God just not ought to be regulated to Sunday. Luke says that Jesus was doing work on a certain day. He didn't want you to get it confused. He didn't want you to have it in your mindset that the only time you should encounter Jesus is on Sunday, or if you're a Sabbath keeper, on the Sabbath day. He says this was a certain day. This could have been on a Monday. It could have happened on a Tuesday. This could have happened on Wednesday. I tell you, Luke didn't give you the option to navigate or to relegate your encounter with God by singling it to a specific day. But he said it was a certain day. Luke says that on a certain day that Master Jesus was teaching. What I need you to understand as we move through this text, I'm going to try and put my homiletics and hermeneutics to work on today, but as we move through this text, it is vital for you to understand that, watch this, wherever Jesus is, church folks will show up. Yeah, believe it or not, here in the Bible, this is why I don't understand how church folks are so, today's church is so easily moved and swayed by what takes place inside of the house of God, because every time Jesus showed up, church folks always had to be there. The Pharisees had it out with him. Can I tell you real quick that there were some folks in the church that were shouting dance and still don't like you? There were some folks in the house of God that lift up holy hands and will cuss you out right there in the sanctuary because they have an agenda, they have a mission. And it is our responsibility to realize and understand that if it happened to Jesus, that we don't stand a chance. Want to be sure to come help me feel good on today. I may have to wear this again. Wow. So the Bible declares that Jesus, watch this, that
Jesus is in his teaching, and the Pharisees and the scribes show up.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
And watch this, they didn't, it wasn't just the locals.
Oh no.
Luke makes it very clear that folks came from out of town.
Uh-huh.
Got on their camel and their horseback to show up.
That's right.
Where Jesus was. Can I help you real quick? That I need you to understand that even the folks don't like you are curious about the God you serve.
All right.
They want to know why you're different from everybody else. And the Bible declares that, watch this, with Jesus being there, and it says that the power of the Lord was present to heal them. Can I tell you that there were folks that come to church only to be spectators, not realizing and understanding that the power to heal them from what ails them is in the Lord. I just had a witness to hear on today. The Bible goes on to say, verse 18, Can I tell you something that real friends won't talk about you when you're distant?
No, sir.
But real friends will stop by and check on you. They'll, not only will they check on you, but they'll do whatever they can in their power. These are the friends that Job had. Now, y'all remember Job's friends.
Yeah.
Job's friends, when Job started going through, they came to him and said, listen, bro, you ain't as, you not as bad as you thought you was. Listen, we know you got some secret sins.
That's what they said.
Yeah, there are some folks that are attached to you that would call themselves your friend that are really trying to figure out why you're going through what you're going through, not because they're trying to see God's power or the hand of God on your life, but rather they're trying to find out what dirt you've been keeping secret from them.
Yeah.
Job's friend said, "You got some mess somewhere. You got to. Yeah, you got some. You got some underlying issues that you ain't told none of us about. That's the only way that God would do this to you. You been, in front of us. You look the part. You have a form of godliness, but you deny the power thereof. Job." But here in Luke 5, the Bible declares that these men didn't go checking to see what was the cause of this issue. But much rather, their main concern was to deliver him from this issue. Their main concern was to bring him out of what he was dealing with. Their main concern was getting him to Jesus. So the Bible declares that they sought out means to bring him in and lay him before him. Real friends, Sister Nikki, will have a desire to get you into the presence of God. Yeah, real friends won't let you live in a pity party too long. Real friends won't let you stay there too long. Real friends won't let you toy with the notion of suicide. Real friends won't let you turn into an alcoholic. Real friends won't let you become a sexual deviant. Real friends won't talk about you behind your back. Real friends want to get you to Jesus.
Yes, God.
The Bible said that they saw different means to get this man there. And then watch this. This is where we lose some of our friends.
Yes, sir.
Because the Bible said that while they were trying to bring him in, that there was a multitude preventing them.
Couldn't get around them.
Some folks are with you until they have to face their obstacles. Some folks are with you until they have to persevere on your behalf. I wonder if we were to really evaluate the people around us, how many folks are willing to go the extra mile for you?
Look out.
Yeah, I'm tired of seeing folks post this status on social media. I don't have anybody that'll do me the way I do them. Now listen, it's time for you to start cutting them Negroes off.
Well,
you ain't got no business around them. They can't be your Facebook friend. They don't need to ride in your car. They can't come to your house, eat your food. If you have acknowledged that they will not do for you what you're willing to do for them, then it's time to cut them off. And can I tell you something? Some of them share DNA with you. You got to cut them folks off. You got to get rid of them. Why? Because they are not conducive to your relationship with Christ.
Come on now.
The Bible says that when they saw the multitude, Sister Barbara didn't deter them.
Well.
But rather they took that as a personal challenge.
That's all it was.
They saw the multitude and decided that listen, since we went to go get him, we gotta see this thing through. I wonder how many of us are here on today can admit that there are some folks that have been with us through some trials and tribulation that have followed through with what they say.
Yeah.
See, unlike God, God has kept every promise to you. Now you may not see it that way, but I promise you, if you can breathe in and breathe out right now, that God has still kept his promise. There's some folks that have told you that they would do something for you. Those of us that go to work, your job has promised to pay you. Whether it be every week or every 2 weeks. And we expect that at the end of that week or at the end of the 2 weeks that our bank account gonna ring and let us know that what they promised would be fulfilled. But there are some folks that you have allowed into your life that have made open-ended promises and they never follow through.
Jesus!
they was nowhere to be found.
Well,
see, that's why I don't want nobody to ride and die with me. Because I, well, first off, I don't want to die. I'm trying to live.
Okay.
So you don't need no, that's part of the problem, is we mislabeled our friends and this my ride or die. And you're mad because they didn't die with you when you started dying. And it's simply because that was never their assignment. There were some folks that were attached to you, assigned to you by God, that was supposed to bring you life, and your initial response to them was to kill them.
All right.
Some of us don't have good friends because we've been bad friends. We ain't gonna don't let me mind my business.
Yeah.
I got that right there.
Come on.
The Bible says that these men, when they saw the multitude, they were not discouraged. It did not dissuade them, and nor did it distract them. It did not cause them to lose focus on what their primary goal was, and that was to get this man to Jesus. It was not only to get him to Jesus, but rather it was to take this man and get him better. So now watch this. Real friends will begin to do things that other folks deem crazy. How do I know that? Because the Bible says that these men show up to where Jesus is. Jesus is at somebody's house.
Right.
And they climb up on the roof.
Yes, sir.
And they cut a hole in somebody else's roof.
That's right.
Y'all missed it. Let me talk to this side of the room. These men were so determined to get their friend better that they were willing to do the outrageous to make it happen. This side of the room ain't getting it. Let me talk to this side of the room. These men were so heaven-bent on making sure that their friend was better, that they were willing to violate the sanctity of someone else's home to make sure that their friend was better. They did not allow the multitude to trick them. They did not allow the multitude to dissuade them. They did not allow the multitude to push them away from their journey, but instead they decided that because I want my friend better, I gotta think outside the box. Yeah, because I want my friend better, I gotta do whatever it takes. And so they decided to watch this. Sister Latrice, they decided to cut a hole in the roof. Now, I don't know who the owner of the home is.
Well, didn't say.
And Luke doesn't find that valuable, but I don't know about you. In our apartment complex, whoever designed it was slow. Because of the way that they arranged the parking. And my wife, she has her parking spot. Not only does she have her parking spot, but she has an ID number that says she is permitted to park there. And we tend to get an attitude like this. We will opt out of driving a specific vehicle just because she don't want to lose her spot. So if she's like that about a parking spot, imagine how this person felt when somebody cut a hole in their roof.
Come on now.
Come here. Come here real quick, color purple. It's going to rain on your head. This man that was paralyzed, the Bible isn't clear on whether or not the man was paralyzed from birth, but I can assume that because of what Jesus says to the man, that he played a part in his own sickness, but that's another book for another day. But the Bible says that these men did not let the crowd stop them, and when they could not get in through the door, they had to go to the extreme. The Bible declares that they took this man, and watch this, not only did they cut a hole in the roof, but now they got one man on the ground in the bed. The other man has got to be there to throw up the rope. They were willing to work together as a team. Real friendship builds character. These men were willing to work to get their friend better. There's some folks that ain't willing, they live around the corner from you and always asking you why you ain't been to their house. There are folks that say, oh, I ain't heard from you a long time, but you got a cell phone just like I got one. Your friends work just as good as mine. You got FaceTime, I got FaceTime, and you want to worry about the last time I called you. When is the last time you called me?
Your brain ain't broke. You better preach that word. You better preach.
Real friendship builds character.
Yes, sir.
These men, Minister Clark, they didn't settle for what they saw.
Uh-huh.
but they were really willing to go the extra mile. I'm getting ready to be done. I'm getting ready to go to my seat. I know y'all tired of hearing me talking. Y'all want y'all fried chicken. But the Bible says that they got up there and they cut a hole in the roof. And after they cut a hole in the roof, then they let the man down. They lowered him in. Now watch this. Watch this. Because the first time I read the text, I missed it. And it was only when I read the text this morning that I got it. Is that these men probably had their own share of power.
That's right.
Yet when it came time to get their friend delivered,
they
stayed on the outside to make sure that he got in. I wish y'all would help
me.
I wish y'all would help me preach this thing like I feel.
Come on.
The Bible says that, watch this, that after they cut the hole in the roof,
that
they lowered him down. They had their own problems, brother. They had their own issues. They had their own struggles that they were dealing with. That, watch this, the Bible says, the Bible declares in verse 17 that the power of God was there and could have healed them too. But watch this, real friends aren't concerned with themselves when it is vital for your success. Real friends don't worry about what they're dealing with because they want you better. And watch this, they will keep themselves on the outside. That you can get what was meant for you.
Come on now.
Yeah, be careful of folks.
Preach.
That want to take you places because so that they can say that they need
it.
Yeah. Be careful of folks that will tell you, I'll take you grocery shopping and I'll even get your groceries only for you to find it on social media later. Oh, this is what I did for so. Be careful of folks who don't want to see you hungry but got their hand out at the same time. Well, I'm going to take you, but I need gas money. Then watch this. If you know I don't have no way to get there, then why would you ask me for gas money? Because if I had the gas money, I could Uber myself. I could drive myself. I could get on the bus and go. But these men decided that it was better for them to stay on the outside. Why? Because they watch this. Because they realized, Sister Nikki, that Jesus' focus didn't need to be on them, but it needed to be on you. Be careful of folks who are always trying to be in the limelight with you.
That's good.
Yeah, be careful of folks who want to be seen with you.
Yeah.
Because they realize that, watch this, if God does it for you, if they're in proximity of what God is doing in your life, that he'll do it in theirs. But watch this, real friends.
Come on, man.
Yeah.
Real friends want you better. Yeah, real friends will put aside what they got going on to make sure that you're better. I'm trying to get through this text. And the Bible says that, watch this, that these friends were so determined to get their friend better that it upset the church.
Hell, Lord.
It did.
Hell, Lord.
Sister Barbara, it bothered the church. Can I tell you that everybody in the house of God does not have the heart of God?
That's right.
Well,
everybody in the house of God does not have the desire to see you better.
Good.
All right. Yeah, and watch this. There were some folks, I would imagine that somebody in the crowd, when seeing this man let down through the roof, said, "No, bro, you need to wait your turn." But for about two of you in here that will receive the word of the Lord, it may not be your turn, but it sure enough is your time. The Bible declares here that these men let him down through the roof, and the church got to talking. And watch this. Not only that, but watch this. The dedication of the friends caused Jesus to respond to the man. The Bible says, and when he saw their faith. Now, it could be concluded that the man's faith was not strong enough. So what I can deduce from that is that real friends will pick up the slack when your faith falls short.
Amen.
Real friends will believe for you when you're unable to believe for yourself. Real friends will see what you cannot see. Real friends will hold on to the outcome that they know God can do, even if you don't see God's hand moving. The I don't know who I'm talking to in here on today, or those of you that may be watching via social media. I need you to understand that if you just believe that he could, that he can. The Bible says that Jesus, after looking at the faith of the friends, talks to the man. There's an old song that we used to sing. I know the church don't sing old songs no more. The old song that says, somebody prayed for me. They had me on their mind. They took a little of their time to pray for me. I'm so glad they prayed. Need you to understand that these friends didn't just let this man stay there, but they were willing to do the outrageous to get him better. They were willing to believe for him what he could not believe for himself. And the Bible says that Jesus responds to the man. Nowhere in the text does it say that the man said anything to Jesus. Doesn't even say that the men said anything to him. But it just simply said that when Jesus saw their faith. Your friends that have real faith don't have to tell you what they're praying for. They don't have to tell you that they're praying for you. They just pray. Real friends don't have to tell you that they got you covered. They just begin to cover you. Wow. Real friends don't have to tell you what they got going on. They just do. You can find out who's really a friend, not by what they say, but by the way they act. These friends were willing to do the outrageous. These friends were willing to get him to Jesus. These friends were willing to do what no one else would do. These friends were willing to go the extra mile for him. These friends were willing to cut a hole in somebody else's roof. These friends were willing to wait on the outside. The Bible says that the church got upset. And they got to talking, and Jesus says to the church, listen, would it be easier? I believe here Jesus is being sarcastic in the text. Jesus said, would it be easier for me to forgive his sins or tell him get up and walk?
You know?
Can I tell you something? That even inside of the body of Christ, there is a handful of people that would just much rather see God do the outcome than God deal with your deep-rooted issues. So Jesus says, listen, I get it that you guys don't understand. But I need you to understand who I am. Here in this text we see the fullness of the Godhead embodied in Jesus when he makes the statement, listen, what I'm about to do now isn't for me, but it's so that you understand who I am. If I get ready to go to my seat, I need you to understand that what God is about to do in your life is not for him, but it's so that folks will know who he is. Amen. Jesus says here in the text, he says, whether it is easier to say, thy sins be forgiven thee, or to rise up and walk, he said, but that you may know that the Son of Man have power upon the earth to forgive sins. He said unto the sick of palsy, I say unto thee, arise and take up thy couch and go into thy house.
Wow.
Here in this text, in the 23rd, 24th verse of this text of Luke chapter number 5, Jesus makes it very clear that when your friends bring you to him, that the transformation that takes place is not because not because of you so much, but it is because he wants to let folks know who he is. He needs people to understand that while they have discounted you and while they have counted you out, that it is the power of God that has brought you out of your dark place. But it is only because you had friends that were willing to go the extra mile. And the Bible says, and immediately he rose up before them and took up that whereon he lay. I need somebody to understand it here today, that your real friends are going to make sure that not only are you better, but the one thing that had you bound, that you'll be able to transport it from where you were. I wish I had a praying church in here. Your real friends, watch this, your real friends will make sure that not only do they get you to Jesus, but then after you're better, that what held you down, that was once your place of comfort, now has to be removed. rose up before them and took up that on where he lay, and he departed to his own house, and he glorified God. At the end of the day, that is our number one obligation. That is our responsibility, that we glorify God. That even in our pain, even in our trials and our tribulations, that we glorify God. It is not for us to be able to brag and say what we did for someone else. But the Bible declares that this happened so that God can get the glory. I need you to understand, as I get ready to close for the final time, that what you have been dealing with and what you have gone through, that the friends that have helped you in your life are not the enemies. The ones that have told you and called you on your mess are not the ones you need to push away, but those are the ones that you need to draw in closer to you, because it is those friends that are telling you, really, when they call you out on your trauma and your mess, that they're willing to go the extra mile for you. It is those friends that are willing to make sure that you get what you need. It is those friends that are willing to get you to Jesus. It is those friends that are willing to get you delivered. It is those friends that are willing to help you get better. It is those friends that are invested in your future. And if you would be wise in this season, you'll understand that that's what friends are for. That's what friends are for. They, real friends want you better. Real friends don't want to see you stuck in the same place. Real friends have an intimate relationship with you. Real friends are willing to go the extra mile. I don't want nobody to blame me when you start deleting them off your Facebook page. That's not my fault, but if you don't exhibit the biblical characteristics of a friend, then I don't even want you as a friend by association.
All right.
I don't want you to be my friend because you know somebody that thinks they know me.
Wow.
It is very vital for us, y'all. I'm done. It is very vital that we understand that on this Christian journey, that believe it or not, we are not alone. It's not just us. But now watch this. We got to make sure that we're making the right decisions. There are some folks that you have allowed to be near you that have no desire to help you. My sister told me this last night while we were having a conversation about a decision I need to make. Sometimes being a friend hurts.
Well,
but there is a difference between hurting folks and harming folks.
Yes, sir.
A real friend will hurt your feelings, not to harm you, but to help you. Real friends will make you mad at them sometimes.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, true.
Not because they're better than you, but they see that you're better than what you're showing.
Uh-huh.
Real friends won't allow you to wallow in your own self-pity. They won't allow you to stay stuck. They won't allow you to be bedridden. They will not allow you to be paralyzed.
Come on.
But they will go that extra mile. And as I go to my seat, I'm reminded of a song that says, "What a friend
we
have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege it is to carry everything to God in prayer." As I started, I said that Abraham was a friend of God. And now I have to ask you, have you shown yourself friendly to the Lord? Have you just gone through the motions of learning church etiquette and church protocol without learning God? Problem with today's church is that we know how to have church, but we don't know how to have relationship with God.
Well,
Why? Because we will come to church and lie to God's face.
Without sin.
We'll come in broken and we'll put on our church smile. We give that I really don't want to talk to you. God bless you.
We'll
sit next to folks that we know we're going to talk about as soon as we leave the building.
Well,
it used to be a time that we made it, folks would wait until they got to the parking lot, but now if you pay attention, next time you go to a church, when service is over with, watch who groups up.
Mm-hmm.
It's the same folks.
Mm-hmm.
And then watch how their conversation changes if you happen to walk over into their group uninvited. We have an obligation, we have a responsibility as the church. I didn't come to preach or prophesy houses and cars are closed, but I did come to challenge you and ask you, what type of friend are you? Are you really the caliber of friend that you say you are? Now listen, please don't throw nothing at me when I say this. But are you the type of friend that you think you deserve?
Hmm.
You want to know who wants to be a friend to you, then start looking at how much of a friend you are to other people.
Amen.
We have a responsibility as the body of Christ to make sure that we're doing things God's way. Listen, it ain't about the numbers. Give me five folks that sold out for God. Give me five people that are sold out for God, that are willing to do the work. Jesus took 12 men and changed the world.
That's right.
He didn't pastor a mega church. He didn't have thousands of members. And everybody that followed him wasn't following. If you're here today and you don't have a relationship with God, now is the time. If you're unsure of your relationship with God, now is the time. If you're here and you don't have a church home, I would love to be your pastor. We would love to be your church family. As we bow our heads, gracious eternal Master, we thank you. Thank you for what our ears have heard and our hearts have learned. Now, Master, don't allow this to just enter into our ear gates, but God, allow this to challenge us to see what type of friend we are. God, allow this word to take residence in our heart, to show us, to be the example, to help us get people to you, and not to get us to ourselves. Master, we thank you for your grace and mercy and all that you have done in the mighty and precious name of Jesus, who is the Christ. And we thank you for him in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. At this time, we're going to take up our offering. I thought about the bucket here. Amen. We're going to take up our offering. Amen. We got Cash App. You like to use Cash App. It is Swag Indie 21. We also have Venmo as well as Givelify.